The diversity of plant life is phenomenal, and one of the pursuits of ecology is to organize and make sense of that diversity. One way to classify this diversity is to describe main dimensions of phenotypic variation. So these trait dimensions reflect different strategies that plants have evolved to be successful in different environments. Trait dimensions are sets of correlated traits reflecting trade-offs among vital physiological functions. Five major dimensions have been identified in the literature, and here I present the three on which I have focused for this work. First, the leaf economic spectrum is probably the best-known trait dimension. It reflects a trade-off between the ability of a leaf to acquire and conserve resources. So for example, some leaves will have a fast metabolic rate, but cannot live very long. On the other hand, you have leaves that have a slow metabolic rate, but they can live long. Some of the traits associated with this trade-off include leaf mass per area, leaf nitrogen concentration, and maximum photosynthetic rate. Second, the wood spectrum describes a three-way trade-off between three conflicting functions: mechanical support, sap transport efficiency, and sap transport safety. Some of the traits associated with this dimension are, for example, wood density, conduit diameter, and modulus of elasticity. The third dimension, called Corner's Rule, is an architectural dimension. It arises because the plant optimizes light acquisition, sap transport, and mechanical support within the limits established by biophysical and metabolic constraints. Some of the traits associated with this dimension are leaf area, twig diameter, and branching frequency. So the concept of trait dimensions is central to our understanding of biodiversity, and it is broadly used in ecology and evolution. However, we still don't know if these dimensions are independent from each other. We often implicitly assume that dimensions are dependent because we tend to measure a single trait to reflect the whole dimension. For example, we'll measure leaf mass per area to reflect the leaf economic spectrum, leaf area to reflect Corner's Rule, the architectural dimension, and wood density to reflect the wood spectrum. However, this approach is only valid if those traits are completely independent from each other. However, natural selection can act to either integrate or modularize groups of traits. In this classical diagram, we see that traits Z and their interaction affect plant performance F. For example, these can be growth or survival. Then these in turn affect plant fitness, W. The diagram on the left illustrates a scenario where it will be beneficial for all the traits of a plant to be coordinated in their response to a selection gradient, for example, any environmental gradient. This would then lead to correlation among all those traits, as shown by the red arrows. In contrast, in the scenario shown on the right, it would be beneficial for only a group of traits to respond to the selection gradient. This would then lead to modularity, or in other words, to independent trait dimensions. Since the literature tends to assume that trait dimensions are independent, this is the hypothesis that I'm testing here. To answer this question, I studied trees on Mont St-Hilaire, a hill located 30 kilometers east of Montreal in Canada. We chose the study site because it has a high local species diversity. That is because it is located in the mixed wood transition zone between the boreal and temperate forest, and it has a unique geological history. Together, these factors have led to a broad range of habitats on the mountain and thus to a high species diversity. We studied the 24 most abundant angiosperm tree species on the mountain. For each species, we measured 15 to 20 saplings, which were 1 to 5 centimeters diameter at breast height. That gave us a total of 380 trees on the mountain. On each tree, we measured 20 traits from all plant organs. So this includes leaves, branches, stems, and roots. Those 20 traits reflect architecture and 5 physiological functions: mechanical support, conductive safety, conductive efficiency, resource acquisition, and resource conservation. So you'll recognize that these functions make up the 3 trait dimensions that I introduced to you earlier. I used 2 statistical approaches to test for the independence of trait dimensions. First, I used a principal component analysis. This is a dimension reduction method that identifies the main axes of variation that are independent from each other, or orthogonal, in a multivariate trait space. So, for example, if trait dimensions are independent from each other, we would expect to see that traits from each dimension will be grouping together along different principal components. So here, for example, we have the wood spectrum traits aligning together along principal component 1, and the leaf economic spectrum traits aligning together on principal component 2. Second, I ran a modularity analysis, which is a type of network analysis. This tests for the independence of modules that are defined a priori. It reports a Q statistic, which gives the ratio of correlations within modules relative to those correlations among modules. And then it compares that ratio to a null model. So if the modules are independent, the Q statistic will be positive, which means that the fraction of intramodule correlations is larger than the fraction expected by chance. Of course, in the analysis here, I define the modules based on trait dimensions. The cartoon drawn here shows a scenario where we would have perfect independence between the modules or the trait dimensions. So here, the dots represent a trait and the lines represent a correlation. So what did we find? In terms of our principal component analysis, first notice that we have four significant principal component. They also explain similar fractions of the total variation, so that means that our multivariate trait space is pretty round and it's not dominated by one or two principal components. Let's look at how each of the trait dimension is correlated with these principal components. First, the wood spectrum traits do not cluster along any principal component. We see that they're all over the principal component by plots. Second, the traits from Korner's rule do cluster pretty well along principal component 2, but we can see that they're also correlated with traits from the wood spectrum, shown in yellow. In terms of the leaf economic spectrum, we find two of the seven traits aligning well with principal component 1, along with two traits from the wood spectrum. And four of the seven traits are somewhat grouped together along principal component 3. So in summary from this analysis, we see that the trait dimensions do not segregate along different principal component, which suggests that the trait dimensions are not independent. Okay, so what do the modularity analyses say? So remember that we expect something like the graph in the top right of your screen. Here's what the trait correlation network of our data looks like. The position of the circles, or the traits, have been optimized by an algorithm to reflect the correlation structure in two dimensions. So the traits that are closer to each other are more strongly correlated. The thickness of the line also reflects the correlation strength. So red dashed lines reflect negative correlations, and solid blue lines reflect positive correlations. Just by looking at the graph, we see that the colors are not grouped together, and that there are a whole lot of correlation between traits from different dimensions. And indeed, the modularity analysis confirmed that trait dimensions do not form independent modules. We get a Q statistic of 0, which indicates that there are as many intramodular correlations as we would expect by chance. In conclusion, here we set out to test whether trait dimensions are independent. But in fact, we find that two of the three trait dimensions are not even there. At this local scale, our traits form an integrated network instead of independent dimensions. A number of other studies have also failed to find trait dimensions at local scales. This means that the trade-offs that shape trait dimensions at large scales are probably not dominating the phenotype at local scales. Together, these findings question whether the trait dimension paradigm is relevant at local scales, which is important because a lot of important ecological processes occur locally.